The president's proposal to cut carbon emissions may not take full effect for several years, but the politics kicked in immediately. In states where nearly all of the electricity is generated by coal, like West Virginia and Kentucky, Democrats were quick to denounce the plan, which they fear would cost jobs. Allison Lundergan Grimes, who is challenging Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell, immediately distanced herself from the plan and from the White House, saying she would, quote, fiercely oppose the president's attack on Kentucky's coal industry. But a recent Washington Post ABC News poll found 70% of Americans actually support curbing greenhouse gas emissions. Joining us for a look at how the decision is resonating politically are Susan Page of USA Today and Reid Wilson of the Washington Post. Sue, let's draw this coal map for us. Does it completely mirror the battleground map we've been watching?
It mirrors a lot of the key states where there are competitive Senate races, control of the Senate at stake in November. States like West Virginia, Arkansas, Kentucky, Louisiana, Colorado. These are states where most of the electricity is generated by coal-fired plants. This may not be a big controversy in some states in this country, but it's a big controversy in the states on which the control of the Senate now hinges.
So is this a regional issue or a national one?
Well, it is a regional issue. A lot of states on the coasts, specifically in the Northeast, have actually curbed carbon emissions quite a lot. The plan by the EPA requires states to curb emissions to a rate 30% less than what they were emitting in 2005. A number of states have actually already met that particular goal. The problem is it's not in that Rust Belt section, Midwest America, where coal is still a huge portion of a state's energy concerns.
Is the concern, Susan, about jobs, mines that would close, or is it about the idea of federal intervention?
It's about both. And the federal intervention argument, I think, works particularly well for opponents of this plan because the president didn't do this through legislation that passed Congress, because he wasn't able to get that legislation through Congress. He's doing this through executive action, regulations at a federal agency. So that fuels the idea, as with the health care plan, that it's a federal mandate on the states. But the argument about jobs is also, I think, an incredibly powerful one in states like Kentucky, which is probably the highest, the Senate race we're looking at most closely because the future of the leading Republican senator is at stake there. The jobs argument is also a powerful one.
There are some leading Democrats who also are facing a pretty tough race in some coal states, and I'm thinking about Mary Landrieu, for instance, in Louisiana.
Mary Landrieu has made her influence on the Senate Energy and Commerce Committee, where she's the chairwoman, a central part of her campaign. She is very pro-drilling. She's pro-fracking, in favor of coal mining. Basically, any energy proposal that you can come up with, she'll back it. Just last week, she took the Secretary of Energy around southern Louisiana. She's trying to tell voters that she is going to be a pro-energy Democrat. Now, more and more voters, though, are voting based on the letter at the end of her name, whether it's a D or an R, than her actual policy proposals in the first place. So that's going to be a difficult challenge for her as she faces one of the toughest re-elections of any candidate running for re-election.
Take us to West Virginia and Alaska, two other states where this is playing out.
West Virginia is a state where the incumbent Democrat is retiring, Senator Rockefeller. We have two strong women candidates. They're both very much opposed, they say, to this plan. But one of them is a Democrat. One of them, Natalie Tennant, the Secretary of State. And so despite her efforts to distance herself from President Obama, this does, it's hard for her to totally argue that she's not a Democrat, even though she differs with the president on this issue.
And Mark Begich in Alaska faces the same problem, and he's an incumbent. So why then does the White House rub salt into the wound on this issue? Why make it so hard for Democrats, especially?
I think it's in large part because President Obama hears the clock ticking. He doesn't have that long left in office. He's only got 2.5 years until his successor takes over. If he doesn't put in this rule now, if he doesn't start the implementation process, the rule won't be finalized by the time he leaves office. If a Republican president is the next one in, they can scrap this rule before it has taken effect. Remember, President Obama's 2008 acceptance speech at the Democratic Convention. He said this would be the time when the planet starts to heal. This is the most aggressive step that any president has taken on climate change so far, but it's a step that clearly puts his party and very vulnerable members seeking re-election at odds with some voters who are going to determine the outcome of the U.S. Senate.
Yet the words climate change didn't show up much in this announcement. It was all about health and children's asthma concerns, and it was in jobs.
Because those are the words that poll better. Those are the words that appeal to a broader range of voters. When you talk about climate change, it's an issue that appeals very much to some voters, but really turns some voters off. And that's why you heard him talk about other aspects of this program, not calling it climate change. But I certainly agree with Reid. You know, the president is thinking about his legacy. Could his legacy be dealing with an issue that he talked about so much in the 2008 campaign, like climate change? Or could it be holding the Democratic Senate? You give him that choice, I think he'd take climate change every day.
But if you are Jean Shaheen in New Hampshire, or Kay Hagan in North Carolina, or Mark Udall in Colorado, would you like his legacy to be a Democratic Senate?
But look at those races you named. Now, there's an interesting test because they are not taking the same tack as we're seeing in Kentucky and West Virginia. Mark Udall in Colorado, who's in a very competitive race, is saying we need to do things like this. We need to address climate change. So is Jean Shaheen. Kay Hagan in North Carolina, in a very close race, is saying we need some balance. So we'll have a test in November about whether this issue is devastating for Democrats or whether it's one that can, where the needle can be threaded.
Is it also one of those issues where there's a lot of money coming from outside these states into it? For instance, we saw there are some pro-environmental money coming into these states on these issues, as well as anti.
Donors who care a lot about climate change are becoming an increasingly large part of the Democratic primary, the Democratic sort of money pool, if you will, led by a billionaire in California named Tom Steyer, who has pledged $100 million of his own money for some key races, including the races that you just mentioned in New Hampshire, in North Carolina, and in Colorado. And the difference between what we've seen in the past and what we're going to see now is, in the past, people who cared a lot about climate change talked about global warming and the rising of the seas and polar bears falling in the water and in the Arctic and all this. And now what they're going to talk about is drought in Iowa and floods in North Carolina, and the sort of immediate everyday impact. Public health is going to be a huge part of it, whether or not your children have asthma. They're going to try to connect climate change to our everyday lives, to everybody's pocketbook issues, if you will, and try to make it resonate on a much more personal level than they have in the past.
And when we stop and think about it, it's not really all that unusual for Democrats to be running against Democratic or Republicans running against Republican presidents in midterm elections.
It's true, but we also know that the popularity of the president is a big factor in a midterm election, especially a six-year midterm. President Obama is stuck in the low 40s, and that is very bad news for these Democrats in competitive races.
Susan Page, Reid Wilson, thank you both very much.
Thank you.